Karlene Petitt is an international airline pilot, author, and speaker. Karlene is a 33-year veteran of flying and now flies an Airbus for an international airline. She is a mother of three daughters and grandmother of six and holds MBA and MHS degrees. She lives in Seattle with her husband of 31 years and is active in promoting safety within the airline industry as well as general aviation. Karlene also speaks at schools, is involved in women in aviation, and supports dreamers of all ages. Her writing career began with designing and authoring training programs for major airlines. Her education and life experiences have allowed her to write a multitude of different genres, from thrillers, mysteries, romances, in addition to nonfiction works in motivation, leadership, aircraft training guides. She has a memoir in the works and recently finished her first children's book. She is currently working on a screenplay based on one of the best thrillers of the year, her novel, Flight for Control. Please welcome Karlene Petitt. Hi, Karlene. Thanks for coming on Savvy Central today. I'm so excited to have you on to speak about your new book, Flight for Control. I was really excited to read your book. I bought it just before going to Oshkosh Air Venture, and I could not put it down. A good portion of my trip, I was reading your book and didn't sleep very much, but it was an awesome, awesome book. Kept me at the edge of my seat.
Hi, Christina. I'm doing great. Thank you, and thanks so much for having me.
I'm excited to have you on. I read your amazing aviation thriller, and you got 5-star ratings on Amazon. Let me read some of the comments we had on Amazon here. You don't have to be an aviation nut to enjoy this book, Strong Women and Suspense. Another one said, my copy came in the mail at 4 p.m., and I couldn't put it down till around 2 a.m. If Tom Clancy wrote about airliners, this would be it. Well, tell me, how did you write an aviation thriller that appealed to everyone?
To tell you, it appeals to men and women, pilots and non-pilots, but of all ages, we have to be a little bit careful on that, because I'd kind of jokingly tell the kids that they're not allowed to read it till they're 23.
Oh, yeah, I understand, because there are some parts.
Yeah, it touches on some sensitive things, and when it's a movie, it'll actually be an R-rated movie, so yeah, it's not for the kids, but they kind of, teenagers are going to be teenagers. Every once in a while, they'll like sneak in and read it. But I actually have quite a younger group that really loves it too, which is amazing because they want to be pilots. And I mentor kids all over the world, you know, both boys and girls. So that's been really fun. But yeah, so back to the question is, how did I write it for everyone? Mm-hmm. Because I was told that I couldn't do that. And they said, no, you can't write something that men and women will like, and you can't write something for aviators and non-aviators. And it was a challenge. But I think the reason I was able to do this is because of being a woman in a man's world. And I've experienced motherhood and all the challenges of the working mother and the guilt and the, am I doing right by my kids, and trying to manage being away from home and setting up and making sure that they're safe and that I'm there for them. Sometimes it meant parenting from afar if I was out in an overnight. And so I've lived that world. And I've also lived in the men's world. And I'm flying airplanes. And I'm not only flying, but I was teaching for many years on the 747 and the 57 and the 737. So I've kind of understand. I'm a total right/left brain person completely. But I've lived in all these worlds. I am married to a non-pilot. We've been married for 31 years, as you mentioned. And so you think after 31 years, he'd pick up some stuff, but he didn't. And so the fun thing was, I was able to write this aviation novel. And then I would say, okay, honey, I want you to read it. And if you don't get something, tell me. And the most interesting thing was, in the very first chapter, when the airplane stalled, he said, but why did the engine quit? Okay. For all you non-aviation people, airplane, when it stalls, the wings stop flying, not the engine. And it just doesn't have that airspeed in the lift, so the airplane will fall out of the sky. And so I thought, no, it didn't. So it really opened my eyes. So what I did is I had readers. I had 747 pilots reading it, and I had non-aviation people reading it. I had my good girlfriends who are, one of them is a fabulous author herself, nothing to do with aviation. She read it. And so I was able to hear what they said and pull it in. So the guys love the investigation. I think everybody loved that because it got, I was able to take people into the aircraft and you got to learn a little bit without really, you know, feeling like you were in a ground school. Mm-hmm. And it was all accurate. I think a lot of stuff is not accurate when we get into technical books if the technical person hasn't written it. But then I was able to really make a very powerful woman's theme through it because, and it touched on the three girlfriends, as you know, one is married with kids and gave up her very professional career to raise the family. And now the girls are 10 years old and she wants to go back to work. So there's that, okay, did the home thing. Now I really want to go back to my job. And what, of course, her husband doesn't want her to. Mm-hmm. Then there's the other character who she just, all she wants to do is stay home with her kids, but she can't because of life circumstances. And then you have our female captain who is not married, doesn't have kids. Everyone thinks she has it all, but she doesn't. There's something missing in her life. And these are all issues that we, all of us women, we deal with and how to balance it. So I snuck this theme in through this book and pulled it all the way through with a very serious thriller and reality-based for all those in the industry of what's really happening in our industries. So I did it. I pulled it off, even though they said no.
No, you really did. You brought me into the world because I'm not very familiar, of course, at all with commercial airline flying. I'm a little familiar with general aviation flying, which is way different and way less structured. I mean, you have to really be trained in general aviation flying, but it's not the same structure as you have going on in commercial. But it was really an interesting world to be brought into. And as well, seeing the dynamics of the women and very strong woman. The main character is a woman who's very strong and pulls the story together and just had me on the edge of my seat. And y'all have to read it.
Awesome. I'm so glad. I mean, this really warms my heart being my first novel because I've written, you know, numerous training programs and I've have two master's degrees. And I really thought, you know, I want to write fiction. I've wanted to do it for over 30 years and all my airline experiences. I'm on my 8th airline now due to bankruptcies and furloughs. So I've lived through that. I know what people have gone through. And I thought, God, there has to be a story here. I need to write this. So I went and did my PhD in writing and by going to writers' conferences and studying with other authors and learning what they did and reading. Oh, I probably have 100 writing books, aviation, well, all my aviation manuals, but all my how to write fiction books. And so I just really, while I was in the process, it took me 2.5 years to write it. But every day I wrote and every day I was reading something on how to, so I could, because it's a different, it's totally different writing aviation from that techie stuff.
Mm-hmm. And that's interesting what you just mentioned there, Karlene, that you spent your time learning the craft before you jumped into it. I love to tell stories myself, but I am not a good writer by any stretch of the imagination. And my friend, who's a novelist as well for children, said, you know, people just think they can just pull out a pen and paper and write a great novel. And it takes a lot of work and training to do that. You have to really practice at it. And I like that you say you practiced every day at the trade and you learned it and practiced at it.
Absolutely. It's kind of like flying. You have to fly to be proficient. You need to write. And when you write, you get better and you learn. And if you're willing to learn, that's probably one of the things I learned early on is that you need to be teachable and you need to be willing to listen to the experts. It's imagine being a wife and mother with kids and grandkids and writing and flying. I'm busy. I'm so busy. I don't have time to just muddle through. I want to do it. And I want to do it right. That probably comes from the pilot side of me and the instructor side. I want to learn right. And I learn very well from other people. Sometimes what they did right and often what they did wrong. But I learn from them because I'm willing to listen. And boy, that will carry through in anything anyone does in their life. You know, it doesn't mean we accept everything we read as gospel. But when you read enough and you start picking up themes, you find what works for you. And there's a wealth of knowledge out there that's open for us. If you saw my bookshelf, I have like tons of books of every genre. So people would, if somebody came in and said, okay, look at this bookshelf and tell us who the person in this room is, they would be totally confused. They go, oh no, there are 10 people live here.
Well, I'd love if you tell the audience, how did you ever get into aviation and flying? And I mean, it was a good some 30 years ago, right? And it must have been a very different world at that time. I'm sure many women didn't fly back then.
Oh, no. And they still don't fly. 6%. They say 6% of pilots are women now. And that's what's going on. Actually, last week, worldwide women of aviation and trying to get more women to fly. I have another thought on that, and there'll be another discussion. But how I started is I actually was 9 years old and I was playing this game called Careers. And it was a board game that we could be a librarian, a stewardess, a nurse, a school teacher, or a model. And it was a little board game. You spun the wheel and you got to move around and get on the spot. And all my girlfriends, they wanted to be a stewardess. That was like the big thing back then. And I, for the life of me, could not get on that spot. So I said, fine, I don't want to be a stewardess. I'm going to be the pilot anyway. And my girlfriend said, you can't be a pilot. And I said, yes, I can. She goes, no, you can't. My dad's a pilot. Girls can't do that. And we got in this huge argument. And then I went and asked my mom, can I be a pilot? And she said, I don't care what you do. Get out of my kitchen. So, you know, it's just like, and I had four, I was the middle of four sisters. And, you know, it's just like everyone teased me and they said, no, you can't do it. And I just kind of, I think this is my personality here now coming out from very young is, A, tell me I can't do it. I'm going to prove you wrong. And B, when I say I'm going to do something, I usually do it. It's kind of like, that's why the power of writing New Year's resolutions or telling people you're on a diet or something, when you tell everyone, it kind of puts it out there. You have to be accountable to it. And so, you know, even at that early age, I thought, okay, now I'm going to tell everyone I'm going to be a pilot. I'm going to do it. And it wasn't until I was 13 years old that I got on my first flight. It was a 727, and my dad was taking us, myself and my sisters, to Disneyland. And I remember walking up and being this, you know, 13-year-old teenage attitude, and I walked up to the cockpit, and I told the guys, I said, I'm going to be a pilot. And I looked around, and there were so many knobs and switches, and I thought, there is no way I can do this. I remember going back and sitting in my seat, and everyone was excited about going to Disneyland. And I probably was pouting. And I'm sitting there thinking, man, my whole life, you know, 9 to 13 is our whole life at that time. But I told everyone I was going to be a pilot. And I'm not going to be able to do it. Somewhere between Disneyland and by the time I got back home, I was back on I'm going to be a pilot. And so now I jokingly say it had to be that there was that elephant down there, Dumbo, who's flying with a feather. And I figured if an elephant can fly with a feather, certainly a woman could fly an airplane. And so I just got back on that path and said I was going to do it. And then when I was 16 years old, I drove myself to the airport to an FBO, which is a fixed base operator where general aviation flies out of. And I said, I would like an introductory flight. And I think at the time it was probably $15 is all. I can tell you how long ago that was. And I remember paid my money and we went out to the airplane. I mean, now I'd tell you, I didn't tell my parents or anything. I just went and did this. And I went out to this airplane and we walked around and he did the exterior inspection and we sat in and he talked to the tower and we taxied out and we got on the runway and he said, okay, you got it. And I said, I don't got it. What do you mean I've got it? And he goes, no, you're going to fly. And so he said, here's the throttle. And he told me how you steer with your feet. And then at 60 knots, I think it was, pull the controls back. And I want you to pitch up this little airplane symbol to this line. And I was just like, my heart's racing so fast. And I put in the power and we're going down the runway and I'm wobbling this airplane a little bit, trying to steer it. And I pulled back and I took off. And at that moment, I thought, wow, they're going to pay me to do this? I was like totally hooked. And the only reason I got in that airplane is because I was told I couldn't do it. And I often want to look back and think, what if I never played that game? What if I never said I was going to do it? Where would my life be now? It's like, but it was something that came so natural and I just loved it. And I'll tell you what, at 16 years old, what an empowering thing to do, to fly an airplane. Only because, you know, it's like you're literally in control of your life. And at 16, you know, teenagers, none of us feel like we're in control of our lives. We've got parents telling us what to do in the school system and everyone's trying to give you guidance or telling you how dumb you are. And then you've got peer pressure, but you get in an airplane and you fly and you are in control. And it's really an awesome feeling. So that's really where it all started. And then I was hooked.
I love that. I love that. I love the fact that they said you couldn't and you did it anyway. I wish more kids would take away that confidence and desire that, hey, if someone tells me I'm not going to do something or I can't do something, watch me.
Exactly. And you know what the funny thing is when I was talking to an agent, I told them about my book. Who's your market? They asked. And I said, oh, my market's for men and for women and for pilots and non-pilots. And they said, you can't do that. And the funny thing is I folded my arms and I looked at them. I had this flashback of when I was 9 years old and told I couldn't be a pilot. You know, now I'm like flying a 747 around the world. And I'm thinking, Yes, I can. You can't tell me no. It's kind of like anything is possible as long as you don't give up.
Yeah, exactly. And I like that you said, because there are a lot of criteria people feel you have to fill, that you must know exactly who your target market is. It's got to be super niche oriented. And in some cases, that's very true. If you're in a really big industry where like 1 billion people are doing it, you want to kind of narrow it down. But I like the fact that you said, no, I'm not going to just pitch it for one group of people. I'm going to make it acceptable for as many people to learn about this, about aviation, and bring them into the world of commercial flying and such. So walk us through how the journey came about, this novel coming together and everything.
Well, here's the thing. I've always wanted to write novels, and I've spent many nights commuting home where I'm too tired to read, and I close my eyes and I can't sleep on an airplane, and I'm thinking about things, and my mind is just like, I'll see something and I think, oh, what if? Okay, so that's kind of been what through my career has been going on. And then I got involved with flying for Northwest Airlines, and I got involved in our union's critical response program, where it's a helping side of our union. And I realized that there's a lot, that pilots are a unique animal in the fact that they're very strong, they're very competent, they're very ego, and they say, I can. It's like you don't want a pilot saying, no, I can't do that approach. You know, you want them strong. These are very, very positive traits. But what I also learned is it can be go on the negative, because what will happen is they don't get help when they need it because they're in denial. And I've got two masters, and one of my masters at the time I was studying is human services. So I did a lot of psychology, what's going on in the counseling arena and what's happening in people's minds. And so I started pulling the two together, and I thought, wow, this is a huge problem that we have pilots who are breaking. And so what we did at the helping side is we were a group of pilots who were available for a pilot to call us when they broke. And the sad thing is we don't want to get them when they break. We want to get to them before they break. And you never want to think that a pilot could emotionally break down. But as we saw with the JetBlue pilot, and it got locked out of the cockpit, it's a very real thing. And industry or just a really challenging environment right now. And at the time when I came up with the thought of this novel is I was dealing in this environment with seeing pilots break, seeing what could happen to them emotionally. And I saw what was happening with the airlines. At the time, I think there were 3 airlines going through bankruptcy. And I was in an instructor meeting, and one of our instructors came in and said, boy, you guys, my son, I just took him to the doctor. It turns out my teenage son has an ulcer. And he said, we got to be really careful about our talk about what's happening in industry. We're taking it home to our children. And then I went home to my family and I thought, well, hey, girls, I said, how come none of you are emotionally distraught over this bankruptcy this time? It's number 7. I've had to start over 7 times at that point. My daughter said, well, Mom, you've always done it before. Why wouldn't you do it now? And I kind of laughed at that. Oh, that's a good point. That's kind of my philosophy. Okay, so now I'm studying counseling and seeing the emotional side and gaining the insight behind human psyche. And I am working in an industry that is being turned upside down, where people are emotionally distraught and they're taking it home that their children are getting, you know, having ulcers. And I'm working for this union and actually seeing pilots breaking. And I went to a meeting, and unfortunately this time they were discussing within that year that there had been 5 pilot suicides. We don't hear about that. And I'm going, wow. So these 3 events are happening at the same time. And then we were going through negotiations, and we had a senior union man said, I don't care what they give us. We are going to shut these blankety blanks down. I don't care what they give us. And he was talking about the contract. He didn't care what the company gave us as a contract. He was so angry at them that he wanted to shut the airline down. And I thought, no, you don't want to shut an airline down. One of my airlines was Braniff, and that was like an old school, you know, airline with husbands and wives, and the whole family worked at these airlines. And you shut an airline down and you impact thousands of lives, thousands, and cities. Take an airline out of the city, and not only it's the people working at the airline, but the people around it, the supporting systems. And so now I'm sitting here thinking, and all of a sudden I thought, wow, how far would a pilot go to take back control? Here, a senior union rep, whether he was just saying this to scare the management where he really felt it. And so I thought, wow, this is something that could be a real story, a story that could be fiction, something that I could write that could entertain and be fiction, but it's really based on reality of everything. So it was kind of like multiple things in life just happened at once and they all came together and this idea sprouted and I thought, I have to write this book. So that's where it came from. And one of the interesting comments was somebody wrote, wow, I wonder if any of this is true. Mm. And then obviously if you go and read the Amazon comments, you read the people who are in the industry and what they are saying about it, which is fascinating. So
yeah, it really, truly is fascinating. And you know what occurred to me while reading it is that throughout the years I've seen as I've gone flying, you know, cut the cost to fly. They're trying to get more and more passengers to fly for cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. And in a lot of cases also had to cut service in order to be able to do that. But you think, like, how much is too low? Like, people really want that cheap ticket and they want it cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. But at what cost? There has to be finally, like, come on, guys, you have to pay a valued service, a valued amount of money so that we can get people, pilots getting paid proper amounts, flight stewardess getting paid proper, and the whole industry being able to function properly.
I know. And that's the thing. That is the problem, because everybody wants safety. But guess what they do? They get on one of the internet search sites for the cheapest tickets they can find. And people will choose an airline for a buck. If they can save $1, they will go to one airline versus the other. And you get what you pay for. You really get what you pay for in this industry. And here's the dollar. The dollar is driving everything. So I don't know, you know, how often. There are a couple airlines that, well, I won't mention here because I'm not going to say anything, but just because I know their training practices, and they're not domestic airlines, by the way, just international, that because I know what goes on behind the scene, because I have worked in there and have seen it firsthand, that I wouldn't buy a ticket on it. Even if they said, we're going to charge you, it can go $20. I wouldn't do it just because I know. But I think the public should probably know that sometimes when you're shopping, if you think that you're going to get an emerald for $20, it's probably not the best quality.
Yeah.
You know, it just isn't. And you need to put that in perspective and know that training costs a lot of money to train pilots. Equipment standards cost a lot of money. It is. It's a very challenging industry, a very challenging time right now with fuel prices and everything. But what we should never scrimp on is the human element behind the operation, because it's really important.
Yes. And to remember that as consumers, that you want to keep paying less and less and less, well, it does. It's going to affect someone, and it could affect you one day as a passenger if your crew and everyone on that ship's not being taken care of. And I myself will admit that I used to penny scrimp in the past. And what really alerted me to is a number of years ago, I went for a flight to Alabama and I got the worst service. Of course, I'm not going to mention names of the airline. I got the worst possible service on that airline. It was really not with the pilots. It was with everyone else. And I was treated horribly. And it's because I was looking for the cheapest ticket. And after that, I said to myself, I'm never, ever going to do that again. I'd rather pay more to go with an airline I know that will not only give me good service, but will be safe, than go with an airline just because it's giving me a few dollars off on a ticket.
Well, and here's an interesting thing that you just brought up, because people will justify, we kind of justify what we do. I'll tell you why. Airline accidents happen because, not because somebody knows what something's happening, but when something does happen, somebody in there knows. This is where CRM and you know, threat and air management came out. Somebody in the flight deck, you can pull off the recording. Somebody knew something wasn't right and they commented, but the brain tries to justify what we're doing, that, oh no, that can't be right because of. Okay, back to what you're saying. I think passengers who will buy those cheap tickets and travel with a really poor service, they're justifying, oh, but the pilots are trained well. They're just scrimping back here so they can save money up there. Not true. It's a culture. I'll tell you what, I've worked for 8 airlines and I travel on many airlines all over the world, and you can tell there is an absolute direct correlation for what type of service you get in the back of the airplane, cleanliness of the airplane, the professionalism of the flight attendants. There is a direct correlation to the type of equipment and you're flying on and the pilots that are flying, because it's a corporate culture. And if the corporate culture will scrimp and give cheap and dirty and non-maintenance, they're doing it an entire company. It is not just in the cabin, which is really interesting. I think when I go back to school to get my PhD, I'm going to get it in organizational management and study the airlines, because there is a direct correlation in a culture, and I can see it. And it, you know, think about the friendly airline that they, you know, they joke about, they tell you jokes on the PA and reasonably priced, and they bebop all over the world. Well, their culture is the same, you know, in the flight deck. It just is. You can tell. I used to joke that if I had six pilots from six different airlines and I had 5 minutes to talk to them, I could tell you which airline they worked for.
Whoa.
Yeah, but it's really not a joke. It really is seriously true, because it's a personality. The culture carries through. Yes, they've been there for a while. So you want to find an airline that is very professional, has a very strong safety culture, and maintains things. I mean, I guarantee you, if you walk down the street and somebody's house probably has weeds and hasn't been painted and the lawn hasn't been mowed, I would highly venture to say there's probably dust inside and laundry laying on the floor. Just a good guess, because not that it's right or wrong, but it just is the personality of what's their importance may be. We're really family and we like to take our kids on trips, so our house is going to let go because it's just a holding place, you know. So it's a personality thing. So it doesn't mean it's right and wrong, but what's happening on the outside is happening on the inside too. It is the way it is. So.
Yeah, I like that analogy, because when I've only taken a couple hours flight training, 13 hours, and very early on when I was doing pre-flight and taking around the airplane, and it was a Piper, we opened up the cowling, we look inside, and I love that this particular airplane in this flight school had, like, you could eat off its engine, it was so clean. And I said that to my teacher, that I feel really safe to get in this airplane because it looks so clean, you could eat off the engine. He said, well, that's a weird thing. I've never heard of that before, that someone feels safe just because the engine looks clean and put together. And I said, well, to me, that's a reflection of how the school treats everything, including the flight instructors it chooses to teach its students. If the, you know, if the flight line looks really clean, if the airplane's inside and out look clean and taken care of and well-maintained, I can pretty much bet that this airplane isn't going to have problems while we go flying in it.
Absolutely. And you were right on that, because it really is. It really is true. I mean, there was a point where they had, when the airlines I worked at, we used to have to wear ties to the simulator. You had to be dressed up to go in and do your flight training. Then it kind of got lax. And I saw the difference. It was amazing what putting just even a dress shirt with a collar and a pair of slacks on somebody coming in, their attitude during a checking event versus somebody in jeans and a t-shirt. It made a difference. And it was the same person. It's just something when now they're dressed, they have to be that just a little bit more professional. And so they took away the ties. We don't have to wear ties anymore. But there is a reason they want, it's a standard. And, mm-hmm. and it is a reflection on, it's a reflection on performance too. So,
most definitely. You perform better when you're dressed. I started working corporate many, many years ago. And when I worked my way into management and started coming into work every day in a suit, I started performing better. It's amazing what a difference is. You walk taller, you perform better. It's just a different presence of mind when you're in that suit.
Exactly. You know, it's kind of like, well, maybe we can associate it. If you ever had a bad hair day, everything goes wrong in your day.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
For those of you just tuning in, we are here with International Airline Pilot Karlene Petitt, who is a wife, mother, grandmother, and recently published her first novel, Flight for Control.
So tell me, what would you say is some of the biggest problems facing commercial aviation today?
Probably on the technology side, the performance side. I'm not going to go into that here because it has to deal with automation. And we're going to come back and talk again, hopefully in about 5 months when the next book comes out, because it's going to be a story behind that theme. But what I can see right now is facing a pilot shortage. And this is a really, really a crisis, because who are going to be our next generation aviators? You know, the young kids, I can't tell you how many emails I get from young people, men and women, who say, I want to be a pilot, but everybody tells me, don't do that. It's a horrible career. They treat you bad. You don't make the money. You can't live on it. And so they write, but they say, but I love it. I love aviation. What do I do? Mm-hmm. You know, it's, I try and, which is kind of ironic. People ask me how I could mentor kids to get into this field. In contrast, write about a very, very serious issue about what's happening in the field. But there's a future here. It is absolutely the best job in the world. I'll tell you, I never would have taken another path. I love it. I love everything about it, except for there's fatigue issues. That's a huge challenge that we're all trying to figure out how to get the rest we need. There's automation issues, which is going to be a serious issue in the future because kids are learning how to fly in automated airplanes. And then they're going into automated airplanes. And when the automation breaks, will they know how to fly their plane? So there's a bunch of stuff happening. But I think if we could focus on finding those pilots who have, those people who have a passion for the sky, there's something with it. It's not for everyone. Just like sitting in an office and doing accounting wouldn't be for everyone. Oh, that would drive me nuts to have a 9-to-5 punching numbers on a computer and filling out paperwork. Okay, so it's not for everyone. But if you have that passion, oh man, you can do so many things. The greatest thing about my job is the flexibility and the time off. I have a wonderful I call it my full-time career, and now I'm able to write. I'm actually going to be a painter. I'm starting to paint. I have time off, days off with my grandkids. And the past privileges, one of my daughters lives in Austin. I can jump on an airplane and go down and see her, which people think it's crazy. I would fly that far for 24 hours, but you can do it. It's just fun. Mm-hmm. We need to find those students and encourage them that there is a future here. But it's really quite interesting because as hard as I try, where are we going to be in 10 years? The technology and the advancement has grown so fast in this industry. Where could we possibly be? That's mm-hmm. the big, big question. But I definitely know we need pilots. And we increased the age requirement, that the mandatory retirement, to 65 5 years ago. And that, I believe in December, those guys are now retiring. And it's going to be a continual flow out. And so anyone who starts right now will be able to be a pilot. They could do it. And here's the other side. I get other pilots who people say, I'm 30 years old and I wanted to learn to fly. I wanted to be a pilot so bad, but I couldn't do it. I couldn't afford it. I don't know how to build my hours. That is a challenge in itself too. I'm looking at, we can fly to your 65. If you're a professional 30-year-old or a professional 40-year-old and you want to do it, go out and do it. Go rent that airplane, get your licenses. And if every day or every week you work towards that career, and on your days off, spend your extra income instead of going on vacation, spend it at the airport, flying an airplane, you meet people out there, do it. You can, you know, imagine in 10 years, you could have enough hours to become an airline pilot, qualify. And even if you're 40 years old, guess what? You still have a 25-year career ahead of you. So even a 30-year-old or 40-year-old who started today, in 5 to 10 years, you could be qualified and be ready for that pilot shortage and still have a very good career ahead of you, which is amazing to me because when I started flying, I thought I had to get my airline job by the time I was 23. But yeah, I think the greatest problem or the greatest challenge we have now is this pilot shortage. Where are we going to get our pilots? How are they going to afford to get trained? Because aviation college is very expensive. Training is very expensive. And they increased minimum requirement to 1,500 hours before you can go get that first job now. So, and back when I was flying, there were more opportunities to build flight hours. We carried bank checks and there's a lot of freight stuff happening back then with small twin engine aircraft that isn't happening today with the world of electronic. Things are shifting. But definitely the pilot shortage is the industry's unique challenge right now, I think.
Wow, I like what I'd love to see come back at the glory in flight. And I think that's what's causing people to, I don't know if I want to do this even though I love flying, is the general public said, oh, you don't want to do flying. That's an awful job. Well, there was a time not too long ago when I was young in the 60s that it was thought of as glorious to be a pilot, that everyone looked up to pilots. And I'd really love to see that come back because what people don't understand out there, general populace, and I only understand a little bit through just a couple hours in training, it is very, very complicated and difficult. It's not like driving a car. I've heard people call flying an airplane like driving a bus. No freaking way. I'm sorry.
I know. It really isn't. But I have to tell you something really funny. My mom said to me once, she said, you know, honey, since women got into aviation, it kind of ruin the mystique and mysteriousness of those airline pilots. Now kind of anyone can do it. And I looked at that, are you kidding me? So I think that, you know, maybe we as women have destroyed that. Maybe it was supposed to be a macho job. I don't know. But here is the interesting thing, because what you said about this glamour mm-hmm. is, I really believe, is part correlation of why pilots are why we're having emotional problems with the pilots that are kind of sprouting up We don't hear about it. But when they started flying, when I started flying, you had to learn what every switch did. We had to know everything about this airplane. We had to know if you were a molecule of air and you went into an intake in the engine, how you went through the system and where you went. We had to draw the electrical system on these airplanes. And then we had an FAA oral where we had to draw out this thing for them. You had to draw out the electronics, the electrical system, the hydraulics. I mean, we had to know our airplanes inside and out. While that is a lot of work and a lot of challenge, it was very rewarding at the end of the day that you could do that and you knew your airplane so well. So now come along these automated airplanes, and they don't really want you to know all that because you don't need to know that because it pops up on a computer screen and tells you. Okay, back then we had to understand weather, and we had to read the weather charts and figure it out and create our own flight plans and determine how where we're going to fly around this weather and how we're going to make our route. And we had to figure out how much fuel we were going to carry and what we needed to carry for our arrival and in case we had to do a missed approach. And you had to know all your regulations. Okay, now in today's world at the airlines, you're flying an automated airplane. And so they want you to, you have to understand how to program and handle this plane. But you're programming an airplane. Dispatch is telling you your routing. They're giving you your weather. Everything is kind of like, it's supposedly, you would think, oh, it's making your job much easier. Mm-hmm. Isn't that good? But what it does, it starts taking away that intrinsic value of this job. It's like something that you did, now you're not doing all this anymore. But you know what? You're making a lot of money and it's a good paycheck. Oh, guess what? Now they're taking away your paycheck. Oh, guess what? You just merged with another carrier. We are going to rip your fourth stripe off, make you be a first officer, make you be under command of somebody else at another airline who hasn't flown as long as you have, and you lose this entire autonomy, and then you get to the end of your career and you think, well, at least I can retire with a pension. Oops, guess what? Pension's gone. And so it really is when there's financial struggles and it's chipping away at the job. It really has. And here's the thing between men and women. I think men more so, their identity is attached to their job. They are what they do. I am an airline captain and that's what I do. Well, I think with women, the job is the job. We're very proud of it, very professional, but we have other interests. You know, the family's priority. We're managing the family and taking care of things. And we like to read and write and paint and work in the garden and plant flowers. Not that men don't like to do those things, but we don't identify with the job as our identity. It's not our identity. It's just part of what we do, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's how boys and men are actually conditioned in our society to see their vocation as their everything. You are primarily as a man to be the provider for the family. And that is how you provide for your family is your vocation. So you strip that from a guy and you've pretty much stripped everything from him.
Absolutely. And then you wonder, how could an airline pilot, I mean, here's the thing, when my novel came out, somebody who had interviewed me at the Women in Aviation Conference last year for on behalf of the conference had read the novel. He read the novel and a few months later decided that he was going to write an article in the newspaper down in Dallas. And it was kind of like airline had given me permission at the conference to interview, and because we're promoting women and actually women in aviation, men, you can come too. It's open for the guys. And what a better place. You go down there and you see 3,000 women who love to fly, and all the airlines are there with their HR department. So guys, come to Women in Aviation because it really is a good thing. But anyway, so I'm down there. He loves it. I got permission to do that. And all of a sudden this article pops up. And I'm thinking, can't have this article out there. But it was done. And it was completely beyond my control. And the fact that they had pictures of me from the previous interview and he read the book. But what transpired from that, which was fascinating, is that it hit down in Dallas during a very critical time at American Airlines. And somebody read this and called the media and said, a pilot from American, and said, American Airlines has had 14 suicides. Turned out that it was only 8. Okay, you know, how wow. Sad to say only 8, but 8 is 8 too many. And 8 pilot suicides at American Airlines in the previous year. And one of the pilots who's involved in their helping side of, you know, called me up and told me that what it did is that brought the media to the doorstep at American Airlines corporate headquarters. Because thinking, okay, wow, for all the effort and what I'm trying to do. You know, it's like we want to create awareness so we can help people. And it did it. You know, it really did it. It really brought it to the forefront and attention. And they were getting ready to cancel their training program. That's one thing all the airlines are canceling are we call recurrent training, where you all come together and annually and, you know, and they're and transitioning it to study at home. And what happens is you lose the power of community. And when mm-hmm. you don't have a power of community and you have nobody to talk to, at least if you came together as a group of pilots in one room, and at American, they're still doing this thankfully, and they're going to be able to continue a little while longer. But what happens is they come into a room and they can say, okay, guys, this is very real. Here's what's happening in the industry. Here's what's happening to you. And if you can get one person to say, you know what, I really lost it last week because of ABC, and I came home and my wife was upset about this, and here's going on with work, and I don't know how to handle this. You know what? It's going to be that much easier in that room that somebody's go, wow, I thought I was the only one who felt like this. This happened to me. And then you can start helping people before it's too late. And so that's what's being lost is this power community. But because of this book, this was brought to the forefront down at American. And now the new merger, you know, we don't know what's going to happen over there with the three groups of people. It'll be quite interesting. All the pilots in the industry are sitting back and watching because the dynamics. But yeah, so fiction can help, I think. And that's really what I wanted to do with my book. I see a lot of issues in our industry, in this wonderful, fabulous, very safe industry. There are a lot of issues going on. Nothing is perfect. And if you pretend it's perfect, you'll never get things fixed. And I'm wise enough to know that just one little person can't take on an industry. So I decided I'm going to entertain. I'm going to educate and entertain through my fiction books and create awareness. And hopefully through that, we can make a difference and make it better. And here's something else that for all the pilots out there, it's kind of a joke. There's some airlines and some pilots, once they get their job, the kind of saying is, yeah, they got theirs, they're going to pull up the ladder because they don't care anymore. And I have a lot of people who say, why are you talking at schools? Why are you involved in flying events? Do your job and go home. I had somebody at a management pilot company told me to give it up and go drink more beer. And I'm thinking, are you serious? Because here's the thing. I want to make it better. This is a great job, and I want it to project into the future for these new pilots coming up. You know, for the next generation, I want to make it good for them and create a path so they can come into a really good job, really safe industry, really, you know, something that they can be proud of. And like you said, bring that glamour back to it, because it is very nice. And, you know, I have to tell you, going international, there's a respect over there. And it's nice because they do respect the pilot. There's a ton of responsibility up there. Flying in the middle of the night, the backside of the clock, the weather's bad. There's a lot of decision making. And then something on your airplane breaks. And you got to pull everything you have at your deepest, darkest hour, 3 a.m., your time zone, and you've been awake for many, many, many hours, and have had minimal sleep, and you got to pull it all together, make it work. And you do it. You do it because you've been trained and you're professional. But you know what? It gets harder and harder when you keep chipping away at the work rules and the salary. And then, you know, you're not going to have a pension and flying to 65. Everybody's different for everything, but you can pretty much see a change in the rapidness. I can watch the older pilots, some of them, not all, but most of them, I would say, the clearance comes in and it takes a little bit longer for it to bounce around in their head before they respond. And that's not for everyone, but so you know what, it's happening. And 65 years old is, you know, the word on the street is people are saying they're going to move it to 67 because of pilot shortage. And I said, no, we want to keep it young. And this is a young person's job. Let them come up and take over. I actually had somebody ask me when I was going to retire at 60 or 65. And I thought, wow, I hadn't thought about that. And I thought, you know what? At 60 years old, if I am mentally and physically capable and we're having a pilot shortage, I will stay on and be there as the captain and the leader and help these kids coming through. If when I'm 60 years old and there is a surplus of pilots and not enough jobs, I will step aside and let those kids have my job because it's time. So it's an individual. But if I was 60 years old and I had kids in college and I couldn't sell my house and I didn't have a pension, you better believe, family comes first. I will keep that job and take care of my family. So every, you know, it's just, yeah. It's really hard to tell. Everything is so unique for people. And I think we can't judge people for what they do because they're, until you walk in their shoes, you don't know why they're doing what they're doing.
Exactly. And I love a number of things you mentioned. Now, you went back to the training, the recurrent training, which is awesome. Like, other industries don't have this, but I love that aviation is very much about keeping with ongoing training. It's not like you just closed the book, you got your pilot license, and bam, you're done. It's a continual learning process. A good pilot is always learning, as I've heard it said. But the cutting back on the recurrent training is also the loss of community, which many in the public wouldn't even dream to think about. But I must tell you, God bless you all who do this job, because when I read your book in particular and saw the difficulties and the challenges of being an airline pilot, I was like blown away, and it gave me a whole new respect. I already had respect for pilots to begin with, but it gave me a whole new respect seeing what you guys have to deal with in the industry.
You are awesome. I think we need to have you as the airline pilot cheerleader.
Yes.
You can be our marketing manager.
Yes, I have no problem with that.
Yeah, no, it is a unique job, and it is, there are challenges, but you know what? I kind of view challenges as opportunity to get better. Mm-hmm. And as you know, flying little airplanes, we fly into the wind. Mm-hmm. That belt gives us strength. We're not going to, you're going to get better that way. And
yeah, and what I would like the general public to get from this is that the next time you think to go on that trip and I want to save a few dollars, think about the entire people behind that flight that it takes to make it a safe flight and a great flight for you. So don't penny pinch on a flight, you know.
Absolutely. You know, it's kind of like would you go to a third world surgeon because you can get your open heart surgery for $400? Probably not.
Yeah, same goes here. So I'd like to hear, what do you have on the horizon for, you know, what would you like to do in the future? What do you have on the horizon? You mentioned a new book coming up.
I do. I'm in the final stages of editing Flight for Safety, my next novel. And I'm also turning Flight for Control into, I'm writing a screenplay, so it will be a movie. And I actually have children's books, a whole series that I'm doing. And then I have three absolutely talented, incredible grown daughters that are, they're just wonderful ladies. So for all the women who think you can't be a mother and be a pilot, you can. But one of my daughters is illustrating one of the children's books. So hopefully that will be out soon. And then I'm also having the works, another book called Flight to Success, based off my blog. My blog, you can go at karlenepettit.com. And it's a blog that I started writing, Flight to Success. And it's very unique in that I do a lot of different things, and I like to support people. But I decided I'm going to write a book, a motivational book for everyone, because there's so many traits to success or things that we do as pilots that really correlate to everyday life. That, you know, focusing, you know, if you just focused on something, there's a lot of power in focus, and pilots know that, you know. But anything you want to do in your life, you could do it if you really learn how to focus and discipline. So each letter in Flight to Success on my blog, I am turning into a motivation. So that's, hopefully I'm going to get that out this year. But I haven't figured out how to get more hours. I'm looking where I can buy a few extra hours in my day, but I haven't managed to figure that out.
When you do, please let me know. I'd like to add a couple myself.
I know. And, you know, the fun thing is because I'm very active in my grandchildren's life. And so it's like, you know, in March, let's, you know, March, we have last week was Women of Aviation Week. This week is Women in Aviation. And so it's kind of the March Madness to open the door and encourage more people to fly. And the reason why we're focusing on the women this month is because only 6% are pilots. And I think I really personally think they don't think they can do it and have a family too. It's challenging, but very doable. And so, then I've got three of my grandkids for 4 days, and Monday I'll be jump seating down to see my grandson in Austin. And so I'm very active in their lives, which is fun. So it's time. I need more time to do it all.
Yeah, I understand. And I like what you just said there about there's lessons to learn through flight that are transferable into life. And one of the first things I got on my discovery flight was how focused you do have to be to fly and how present I became in that flight. I was never more present in my entire life as I was in that discovery flight.
You know, and this is really interesting because this could be an entire new discussion. I actually go to yoga when I'm home. I try and do that every morning. And it's very good exercise, but yoga and meditation is about being present in your life. And I look back at what's so wonderful about when I fly, even today, and I get up there and I'm flying across the ocean and I'm just present. And it's my time of my chaotic life that the phone is not ringing. I'm not doing something for somebody. It's so calming to me to be present and focused on that airplane. It's like when I took a painting class, and years ago I took a watercolor class with my girlfriend, and we started at 8 a.m. and all of a sudden they said, it's 5:00, time to go home. I'm going, no, because I was so into color and doing it. And I think there's so much power into, you think focus is going to make you exhausted, but not necessarily. You know, it's, you're being one. It's kind of like being one with the airplane, being one with your life. It's just, it's a very rejuvenating feeling. And I think that's why when I started flying and it felt so nice, it's because I felt, it was a feeling. It was a feeling of being present and calm. And it's just like tranquil. It's like you're, you know, imagine you're a leaf just floating on the wind. It's just, it's really something.
No, I agree. It is a tremendous experience. For anyone who hasn't experienced it, I suggest just taking a discovery flight just to see what it's like. And as far as the 6% goes, I can imagine why that still exists a little bit, because even when I did go to take a discovery flight, I was discouraged a little bit at some of the flight schools I went to check out from taking a discovery flight. Oh, do you want to fly? Yeah. They were kind of like, well, you're really not going to go all the way through with it because you're a girl. And there's still that little sentiment out there that it, as a girl, you shouldn't be flying. So, but don't let that stop you, anyone, because look at Karlene. She did it. And I'm going to do it one day and get my pilot license. So don't let that stop you, anyone out there.
Yeah, it's changing. It was quite interesting because my husband and I were talking about that today. It's kind of like one day when there people don't comment about, oh, you're a female pilot, they just say you're a pilot. You know, we'll get there. It just isn't there yet. I can hardly wait till the day that people aren't impressed that I'm a woman pilot, if that makes sense, you know? And I have to tell you really something really funny. My youngest daughter, who is 27 now, when my book came out, my novel came out, and she read it, and she said, Mom, I can't believe, oh my gosh, you really wrote a novel, and it's good. You really wrote a novel. It's really good. And she was so shocked. And I'm looking at her, and I'm thinking, this comes from a child who's completely shocked that I wrote a novel, but she had no, it was like, oh, you're a 747 pilot and instructing these old guys how to fly this airplane? There was like no amazement to that, but the amazement was I wrote a book. So my kids are kind of like in that, it's like not a big deal. Why is it a big deal about girls flying or about boys if girls can do it?
I love it.
Yeah, it's really fun. But it's a great career, and I really encourage anyone who wants to do it. And this, an opportunity, whether you're a teenager or 20, 30, even 40 years old, if you decide your midlife crisis that I do not like my job and I've got a pension here and money here and I can afford, instead of buying that new car, I'll go out and get my pilot's license and see what it's like. I say go for it. This is like our only life.
That's right. You only live once, so make it happen. If you have a dream, and nothing is sadder to have been on your deathbed to say, hey, I wish I had learned to fly and I wanted to and I didn't. So don't let it pass you, man. If you really want to do it, at least take that discovery flight. See if it really is for you.
Yeah, and you will know, you know, you will know. And that's why, you know, we're opening doors every, you know, and anyone who wants to fly, every first week in March, the Women of Aviation worldwide, they're opening doors, and all over the world, we're giving free flights to people just to see if they like it. So Right. It's pretty fun.
Awesome. What last words of advice would you like to leave our listeners with, Karlene?
I think that I would like to tell everyone, this is your one and only life, and find what you love and do it. Don't let people tell you can't. Don't let, you know, it's, there's two in a story. You've got a protagonist and an antagonist, and they're driven in there. You know, this antagonist is fighting you. In real life, we've got the protagonist is ourselves, but we've got two antagonists, those people outside of you telling you can't, but also that antagonist inside of you, the doubt, telling you can't. You know what? Sculpt it all. Just know that you can and ask yourself why not. And another thing is, there is absolutely no way that you have failed until you give up. You know what? Just keep doing it because it will work out. It's life is a dirty, messy challenge at times, but it's incredible. It's fun. And and just do what you can. That's why when everyone's telling me, do you know how hard it is to get a screenplay made? I'm going, you know what? There has been nothing in my life that I haven't said I'm going to do that I do. Sometimes some things take a little bit longer and a little bit more creativity, but you can do it. And if I can do it, anyone can do it.
I love that advice. It's great. The only time you really fail is when you give up. So that's tremendous advice.
For everyone else, go get Flight for Control. Check out Amazon. You'll see the comments. And if you want an autographed copy, you can get off my blog too.
Great. Well, let them know again how they can get your blog and if you have any other details you'd like them to get in contact with you.
Yeah. My blog is at KarlenePettit.com. Actually, it's just KarlenePettit.com. If you want to go to Blogspot, Karlene.Petit@Blogspot.com. But Karlene Petitt, and Petitt is P-E-T-I-T-T. And you can Google Flight to Success. You can Google Flight for Control. You can Google Karlene Petitt and you will find quite a few links. And so you will be able to find me if you do that. And check out Amazon, read the comments. They're quite good. I can't tell you how excited I am for my first novel to have been such a hit. I'm just like kind of awestruck.
No, but you did a fabulous job in bringing us into the commercial airline world. And thank you so much. And for bringing a lot of issues to the forefront that will make us more aware as a society. And hopefully together we can make it a safer, greater industry for all of us. So thank you again, Karlene, for coming on Savvy Central Radio.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Join us this Friday, March 15th, where our guest will be Elizabeth McCormick, Black Hawk helicopter pilot.